Welcome to the April 20th, 2017 Reactive Consciousness Podcast. I am your host, Vise the Bold, and this is...
Lotus Prince, who continues to be unfired.
And Old Man Snoppy, who has now fired Pyrojack, I suppose.
That's right.
it's a round-robin firing.
When do we fire Vise? He's always here.
Soon I will usurp the throne. I'll be the host. I'll give the way in.
He was boldly shoved off his own show. Well, I actually can't wait for that episode because I can't wait to hear the beginning of what of the episodes which I'm not there.
It's just 15 minutes of silence while we try to decide who's supposed to talk next.
What do you think?
I don't want to be rude, but...
What do you think Vice's weigh-in would have been?
So, once again, this is Reactive Consciousness, our in-depth podcast about what happened this week in pop culture. So this week, we have a couple different... topics here, one in which I'm very well versed in, and I'm actually Pyro will be kind of a little miffed that we talked about this one, but I'm gonna go with it, and Old Man Stompy has one that's close to his heart, so would you like to take it away?
Sure. So I've already sort of carved out my niche in this podcast as the wrestling guy, but I'm also a big fan of Magic the Gathering, probably way more than anybody else who's been on this podcast thus far.
Pyro and Lotus are into it, at least to some extent. I used to be back in high school and middle school, yeah. So I do know what you're talking about.
I was in college, but I still have my cards, but I fell off the wagon years ago.
I have played with Pyro before, but he's definitely on the casual level.
I don't mean
that like to impugn him in any way. Just that I definitely play a lot more Magic than he does.
Oh, you just shat all over him. That's what you were saying.
Pyro's gonna fire you so hard.
He only play one color per deck.
He'll have to beat me at Magic the Gathering first.
Old Man Stompy's like, get on my level.
So anyway, I kind of wanted to talk about this a little bit for a couple of reasons, one of which is that there's a new set coming out. Stop me if you've heard this one before, but the set is called Amonkhet, and it's Egyptian-themed, and it features Egyptian god cards.
That sounds amazing.
Wait, doesn't it take place in a totally separate world that doesn't have
The Shadow Realm, yes.
Yes, it takes place in the world where we care about anime. So I don't want to belabor this point, but in Undertale, anime is literally in the garbage.
Like, yeah, it's pretty funny.
That's a tremendous running gag in the game.
It's great.
So anyway, part of why I found this so interesting is that at GDC 16. The lead designer of Magic the Gathering, Mark Rosewater, gave a talk on the lessons that he learned designing Magic the Gathering over the course of the last 22 years. He has only ever had one job in game design. He was hired to work for Magic the Gathering in 1995 as part of Wizards of the Coast. Before that, he was a communications major, and he was a Hollywood writer. So he's been developing nothing but Magic the Gathering since 1995. For reference, the game was first released in 1993.
Yeah.
So he has been part of the Magic the Gathering family for almost its entire lifespan.
Yeah, since like 4th edition, I guess.
So he gave I think it was actually earlier than that. I think it started with Tempest. So it was in that vein, in that range.
Okay. Tempest is actually my favorite set.
I love Tempest.
Tempest is great.
So you can imagine he likes it a lot too, because it was his first. So So he gave a talk at GDC 16 regarding what he called 20 years, 20 lessons that encompassed his last 20 years working in Magic the Gathering and the lessons that he learned. Not one per year, but 20 things he thought were integral lessons for any game developer. And it turned out to be voted the best talk of the conference.
Wow.
It is available on their YouTube page. It is extremely interesting. He also has a podcast. Not that I want to, like, get free advertisement to our competitors, but we're no competition for him. He's very
They're directly competing with us. If we could only beat out Mark Rosewater, then we'd be the number one.
How you have a self-deprecating dig in there while talking about it. He's actually interesting.
Yes.
Wow.
When I don't play a lot of Magic anymore. But I find it really interesting to listen to his podcasts and to see how each individual set encapsulates the lessons that they've learned over the course of 20 years of Magic. And I have a lot of appreciation for, like, how finely tuned every Magic set is and how much effort goes into developing them.
It's kind of like Yu-Gi-Oh, right?
It is nothing like Yu-Gi-Oh.
No, actually, it is kind of interesting.
Shut the fuck up.
No, it is.
It's made by Konami. It's got to be good.
Yeah, it is kind of interesting seeing. Actually, two things. One, really quickly, on our Police Nods Let's Play, when the Konami logo popped up on episode one, I distinctly remember you saying, "When I see the Konami, like, I just know that's like a sign of quality or like something like that." So that's just funny to me. So, but no, the other thing is, though, it's interesting seeing Yu-Gi-Oh players like learn Magic because they're so insistent on attacking specific creatures rather than
yes,
you know, you and you block with those creatures. That was it.
Right, so that's very different from Magic, where you attack the player and they block with the creatures, or Hearthstone, where sometimes you can attack the creatures. On that note, since I'm also a DDR player, Konami is affectionately known as Konmai because they misspelled their own company name on the ID card entry page for one of the Bimani games. So
Resident Evil Revelations.
It's known as Konmai Quality because of Konami forgetting to spell how to spell their own names.
The problem is Konami used to be like a good sign of quality, like on the NES and Super Nintendo and Genesis. Like you knew it was going to be a good game.
That was a long time ago.
Yeah, it's a shame.
Oh, so anyway, to get a little bit back into Magic, not that I don't think Konami is very interesting. So like back in the day, you know, Magic was one of the first collectible card games. And it wasn't expected that players would have all the cards. It wasn't expected the game would become as popular as it was. So, like, some of the cards are, like, ridiculously overpowered because it was assumed that people would just buy packs and they would have, like, one, maybe two copies of the really powerful stuff.
And Ante was a rule.
And Ante was a rule, yes. If you won a game, you got a card from your opponent's deck.
Like, there are some...
Pogs?
Yeah.
Like Pogs. Yeah.
Like, there are some old cards that are banned now because they specifically bring up the Ante rule. Like there's a card called Bronze Tablet, which I think its gimmick is you replace whatever your Ante card is with it. So even if the opponent beats you, it's like, here, have Bronze Tablet instead of whatever super card you were going to get.
So in memorial to that, at one of the invitationals, one of the player invitationals, like 10 years ago or so, well after the Ante rule was abolished, they had a special match between two invited players where the goal was to win the largest value of Ante cards.
That's insane.
And so the goal, the strategy to win at Ante turned out to be to win one match and then to use the cheapest version of that card that you mentioned that you can find that has, like, because it's from Chronicles, it's really easy to find a copy of.
Oh,
Chronicles was a mass reprinted set early in Magic's history of a lot of cards that tanked the value of those cards. So if you have like a Chronicles Jeweled Bird or Bronze Tablet, they're worth like a penny. So you just get those cards and you put them into the Ante, and then since you've already won the first round, your opponent can never win the match. There's no possible way for them to earn enough money to overtake your first win.
Yeah, there were some really old, you know, the really old sets in Magic, like Antiquities, Arabian Nights, and Legends. Chronicles, it was not an original set. Like, the entire set was reprints of those old cards. So, yeah, that's how you get away with that.
So, these days, there's been a lot of active development in terms of understanding how players get into a game and how players get invested in a game. And part of the talk goes into this to some extent, but some of it is one of the favorite cards that people like to look back at in terms of Magic's history is a card called Balduvian Shaman. And
what?
It's a card. Let me see if I can call it up real quick.
Yeah, but the I forgot what Balduvian things were. It was like some group of people, but yeah, a shaman of them.
All right. So here's the text of Balduvian Shaman.
Oh boy.
It says, tap, change the text of target white enchantment you control that doesn't have cumulative upkeep.
Jesus.
By replacing all instances of one color word with another.
That's the most even if you can understand that's the most useless card in the world.
And then it goes on to say, for example, you may change black creatures can attack to blue creatures can attack. That enchantment then gains cumulative upkeep 1, meaning at the beginning of its controller's upkeep, that player puts an age counter on it, then sacrifices it unless he or she pays his upkeep cost for each age counter on it. So this is a common card, meaning that if you bought a pack of the set this was in back in 1995 or 6, whenever it came out, you were very likely to open this card, and you would read this massive block of text printed in extremely small font, and the payoff would be, oh, I can change the color on one of my enchantments?
But it's like, yeah, it's a white enchantment. Like how many of those do you even have? Like, oh, I'm going to change circle. Like, I'm going to change circle of protection blue to circle of protection red. Wow, cool. Like,
yeah, well, that actually is a pretty powerful effect, but you'd never know that that card even existed just by reading Balduvian Shaman.
Yeah.
Balduvian Shaman, by the way, is a blue card, so you wouldn't even play it necessarily in the same deck.
You must be playing blue-white.
Yeah. So, one of the things they did about maybe 7 or 8 years ago was to establish what they called New World Order, where the complexity of a card is relative to its rarity.
Okay.
Meaning all of the common cards are extremely simple. The uncommon cards are a little bit more complex, and they build into the set's major themes. They're like build-around-me cards, so you'll have a bunch of them, but not too many. And you can build decks around them. And the rare cards have like really exciting and interesting and unique effects. Another thing they did is to take advantage of sort of the equity that their players come into the game with. So a lot of the recent sets have been built around existing pop culture themes or existing historical themes. So there's a world called Innistrad, which is built around gothic horror. So there are vampires there's like vampires that transform into bats. There's zombies. There's the blob monster. There's all these things from horror movies.
Neat.
Yeah, and the new set is called Amonkhet. So it's built around Egyptian mythology. So the storyline of the set, part of what they're trying to do now is I can appreciate the challenge of what they're trying to do, which is to have a character-driven story, is the latest thing they've brought into the game. They have these like planeswalker cards and these legendary creatures that represent unique characters in the storyline, and they're trying to have the story revolve around them. They tried this like way back in the 90s.
Yeah, I was going to say, in Tempest, the whole Weatherlight saga.
Yeah. Yeah, they had a whole saga that was supposed to be told on the cards.
And it was awesome.
Yeah, it was interesting, but it was really hard to follow.
Yeah.
So they're trying it again. They have
like
what's
Squee
called
and Squee.
Yeah,
like
Squee Goblin Nabob.
So Squee was a goblin character who would show up on a bunch of cards, and you would find out his fate. He became immortal, which is weird. Like,
yeah, he was the comic relief character.
So he would die a lot for slapstick comedy, and then he would just come back as though nothing happened. That was actually also his card mechanic. He could be, if he died, he would just go back to your hand all the time.
That was a really cool aspect of that set. Yeah.
So the set is now themed around this guy, Gideon. He's a planeswalker from another set themed around Greek mythology.
Oh wow!
So he comes from this world where people worshipped the magic equivalents of the Greek gods.
And so that makes total sense, because like the Greeks interacted with the Egyptians.
Of course. So now he comes to this new world, and it turns out it's also a front for Nicol Bolas, who's the magic world's major supervillain.
Oh, I heard he was back. Yeah, Nicol Bolas was from way the hell back in Legends. He was an Elder Dragon legend, and it's like from like 1994, and now he's just back.
So the magic like storyline has been retconned a little bit, that like every major bad thing that's happened in the last like, ever since the end of the invasion block, ever since the end of the Weatherlight saga, has been like Nicol Bolas' fault in some way.
God damn. I didn't know he was a bad guy. I just know he was like, because his picture was just like a sage-looking dragon reading a bunch of books in this giant library-looking room. Like, I didn't really get lore behind this character.
Yeah, so the new set is all about the Egyptian theme of trying to become honored in the afterlife. And Nicol Bolas has these five gods that are based on the five colors of magic. And it's they're putting the people of this world through all these trials that end when you die. And so Gideon comes to this world thinking that it reminds him of home. And then he finds out over time how cruel and survival of the fittest the world is. That establishes the primary conflict. Huh. And it's told through the cards, which is... it's a challenge. You know, if you open a pack of cards, you might not have any of the storyline cards on it. So how would you know what the storyline is? It's a very difficult story to tell. And so I can appreciate the challenge of what they're trying to do, you know, to make it so that you can understand what's going on the world of Amonkhet just opening an arbitrary pack.
Do they still make the novels?
They publish vignettes on the website. They don't publish the novels anymore. They moved to e-reader novels for a while. But I don't think they even do that anymore. They're trying to tell stories, and some of them are very interesting. They're trying to tell stories via the website, so it's free, so you can just read it.
That's pretty rad.
Okay. Well, that's cool.
Do they have any other Elder Dragon legends, or is Nicol Bolas, like, the guy? Like, there's no more, like, Vevictus Esmadi or anything?
So, they did a kind of interesting story on a plane called Tarkir, which was inspired by Mongolian culture. And they had Elder Dragons. They actually had the creature type Elder Dragon.
Nice.
And they were legendary. And so, the idea is that this planeswalker, who's one of the new storyline characters, his name's Sarkinvol. And he comes to this plane where the humans have killed all the dragons. And he's a dragon mage. He loves dragons.
Oh, I heard about this, yeah.
Where dragons were all over the place. And so he travels back in time to bring the dragons back to life. Because the dragons, their leader, this guy Ugin, is like the god to Nicol Bolas' devil. So he's like the big good of the series. Although he's a dragon, so his morality is a little bit...
a little more chaotic.
a little hard to pin down. So the punchline to the story is that it's a time travel story where Sarkin is really happy because he brought the dragons back, but all the humans are like, oh, fuck. You know,
yeah, because there's dragons there.
Well, yeah, it's like Rain of Fire. It's like, what have we done?
and they're, like, miserable because, you know, because the dragon overlords have returned from antiquity. And it's time travel story, so they never even knew how good they had it. You know, before he went back to change things. So it's a take on time travel where the guy who affected change is happy with the results and he's presented as the protagonist, but man, did he really fuck things up on purpose.
That's interesting.
Like, not even as an unintended consequence. He did exactly
that was the one thing you wanted, yeah.
That's kind of like going back, you know, like a phlebotomist goes back in time and releases the bubonic plague again. Like,
it's kind of like how, you know, like all time travel plots somehow revolve around killing Hitler. Like, imagine a time travel plot evolving around going back in time to save Hitler because you were curious about how World War II would turn out if Germany won.
Probably. Well,
we have Call of Duty games for that.
I think the point of him killing himself was that Germany wouldn't have won.
Well, it's a time travel story. It doesn't have to satisfy do what you want. Logic. Yes,
I mean, he killed himself because he was about to be captured.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, what if you time traveled so he wasn't about to be captured and didn't have to kill himself?
You would have to do something else.
What if Germany won there? Although, from what I've seen, I think literally every time travel story, at least that I've seen, the moral is no matter what you were trying, just don't. Because most time travel stories I've seen involve, oh shit, this is what the world's like now, or doing your best to undo what you did. Like we talked about Steins Gate.
Oh,
on,
I wish I didn't. You hadn't kill killed that fish.
But we talked about Steins Gate on the Corrective Con Consciousness podcast this week, and that's a show where the entire plot is try to undo every aspect of everything you did in like episode 5. it's just like, oh no. So yes.
So anyway, Tarkir aside, I encourage everybody to listen to this talk. It's a great talk to listen to if you're an aspiring game designer, and it helps a lot in trying to analyze why you do or do not like a certain game. Most of his points revolve around trying to understand what sort of emotional response you're trying to get out of your gamers, and to put as little as you can in the way of your game allowing them to invoke that response. So, for example, you know, when you play a Sonic the Hedgehog the game, you know, the emotional response is just that you're trying to go fast. You know, you're trying to play a character who's extremely agile, who controls really well, and most of the early Sega Genesis games hit this note.
One other thing I might add, just real quick. Mm-hmm. One thing that they've discovered is a big part of why those things feel good is the actual weight of the physics of Sonic. Like, the weight and physics of Sonic is a big part. It's not just about speed, it's about momentum.
Yeah.
Right. With those games. So everybody thought it was about speed, and that's the reason why they like it, and that's actually not the case.
No, I've noticed.
It's the speed combined with the momentum.
Well, yeah, most notably, if you're in a pit that's curved, and you dash attack up, like, the left side, and then you're hanging in the air from the height you've gained, and then you drop down and go back up the other side, you go considerably higher because you actually had gravity work. definitely helps.
So that's part of it, that a character should do what you expect them to do, you know, when you input a certain set of controls, and it should also jive with logically what you expect to happen. And the less that makes sense, the harder it is for a player to get into your game. Mm-hmm. Like, that's why people don't like the rain mechanic in Breath of the Wild.
Yeah.
Because the game is about exploration.
And climbing.
And a lot of climbing. And it randomly stops you from getting somewhere where you need to be or want to be. And the game is expansive enough that it doesn't usually affect the gameplay, because you can always just go somewhere else. You can always continue going downhill. And sometimes they use this as a tool, you know, to direct you downhill. Like, some of the rainiest areas in the game are in the south part of the map, which sort of vaguely trends downhill, and they want to push you in that direction.
Yeah, and not only that, but some of the areas are specifically themed, so they're very difficult to get where you want to get there,
right?
Because it's perpetually raining there.
Yeah, but sometimes you're just climbing a mountain, and it's a tall mountain, so it takes a while, and then it just starts raining, and you're like, well, now what do I do?
Now I have to wait for a half hour and fuck off and do something else.
Yep. So the only other thing I would mention is that so back in 1993, Magic featured cards like Ancestral Recall, which is notoriously the most powerful card in the game by most measures, costs one mana. So if you're not familiar with Magic,
basic currency.
It's a resource system. You play a land a turn, and then you play a spell. You have that much mana accessible on that turn.
Yes, you could play this on turn one.
Yeah, and it draws three cards. So
yeah, that is nuts.
For reference, that's extremely powerful. In fact, it's so powerful that it's difficult to design a card that you would play ahead of Ancestral Recall, and it's almost impossible to design a card that you would put in a set which is more powerful. So what they've been trying to do in recent years is to discover the bell curve of what appropriate effects are for their mana cost, and to sort of pare that down. But it's difficult to do, because if the game isn't exciting and you don't feel like your spells are powerful, or that they're not more powerful than the spells your opponents are casting, the game doesn't appeal to people. You have to feel like a powerful mage. You have to feel like you're summoning powerful creatures, big dragons that can kill your opponents. And if your spells aren't powerful, then the game doesn't feel interactive. You know,
also the whole luck component of wow, will I get this powerful card or not?
Right.
Is like a big part of what makes Magic fun.
Yeah, so that's another strong balancing act that Magic has to achieve that a lot of game designers don't entirely understand a lot of the time. Is that so? Mark Rosewater calls it like stickiness or something. He ascribes some word to it that. Because of the slight random element to Magic, I mean, it's non-trivial, but it exists, you often feel, even if you lost, that you tell yourself, oh, I could have won if I just drawn, you know, my dragon, or if I just drawn my counterspell for the spell that you used to win the game. If I just drawn slightly better, I could have won the game. And you come to the next game thinking, oh, I definitely could beat you this time if I just draw the right sequence of cards. But you also take that lesson back and think to yourself, if I'd had a better ratio of, you know, the cards mm-hmm. I needed to win versus the cards that didn't really help me in this game, you will design your deck to have a higher...
So it's just like a poker player, right? Yeah. Like, you can't... Everybody draws from the same deck in that game.
Right.
So you can play poorly, but like a really great poker player will know what to do in most of those situations, and then there's luck element, right?
Yes.
Well, like if you are the one designing your deck, you should design it in a way in which, yeah, bad luck can happen. Bad luck can always happen, but mm-hmm. your chances of being able to play a decent hand or a decent game are pretty high.
Right. Unsurprisingly, a lot of Magic players are also poker players. There is sure. a lot of intermingling. I would like to make one last note, and this is actually directed more towards our viewers, Magic is a game which has a pretty wide audience at this point, and they do this by having their own sort of understanding psychologically of what their players bring to the game and what sort of experiences they're trying to have. So I talked a lot about emotional experiences. And they have three player psychographics that deal with what players want to experience when they're playing Magic on the very broad level, and two that deal with how they interact with the game on a mechanical level. I would encourage our listeners, if they're interested, to try to understand and maybe post in the comments of whatever venue they're listening to tell us what psychographic they think they fall into, because it'll tell you a lot about what you're getting out of the games that we play. And since we talk about video games here all the time, it might be kind of interesting. So on the mechanical side, there's what they call Melvin and Vorthos. So Vorthos is a player who wants the card to have a really strong resonant effect. If I cast an ice spell on you, that player wants to feel like it's freezing you in your tracks, and the mechanics should do whatever is necessary to create that feeling.
Like keep land tapped for an extra turn, for example.
Yeah, so like Frost Breath, which is notorious among our group because Perry, who we've discussed previously in this podcast, likes to blow on the cards.
Yeah, he'd always go like whenever you play the card. It sounds really corny.
So that card doesn't do anything but tap your cards and prevent them from untapping, meaning you can't attack with them the next turn. But, you know, it feels like you're blowing Frost Breath on them, and it freezes them over for a little bit, and then they can't attack next turn until mm-hmm. they thaw out.
Yeah.
So a Melvin wants the cards to make mechanical sense within the rules. He wants it to create interesting rule interactions that you can exploit as you're playing the game. He wants it to be clean mechanically. So if you ever played a game and you thought that the rules were too complicated, or that the rules didn't make sense, or that then you might be a Melvin. On the psychographic side, in terms of the experience, the players' psychographics are called Timmy, Johnny, and Spike, and there's now a gender-neutral alternative, so you can also be Tammy or Jenny, and Spike is relatively gender-neutral, so they kept that one. Timmy is a player who wants an experience. So, for example, Timmy wants to attack with a giant dragon, or like Timmy wants to counter all your spells and make it impossible for you to play the game. Often has no correlation with winning whatsoever.
I hate those that type of player, by the way.
Well, that's funny because sometimes like you and a lot of people I know become Timmies like when you're playing a game and like there's no hope of victory. I do this too. Like a Timmy will be like a player in Scrabble who only wants to make 7-letter words.
Yeah, so like for instance, when I used to play, I was a black or green deck kind of person, and black and just for viewer knowledge or listener knowledge, black and green are very much very easy to understand in that they summon a lot of physical monsters and they attack things. Both of those colors do that. They have a lot in common with each other. Now, then there's white, which tends to be defensive. So it just kind of, like, will cast spells to stop you from doing any damage to to people. And then blue is just a pain in the fucking ass.
Yeah, blue is nightmare.
A blue player is a Timmy in every sense of the word. So blue players will stop you from doing anything you want to do, and will invalidate your spells. You will tap mana to bring out a really nice big legend character, and then they will just tell you, no, you can't do that.
Yeah, here's what's irritating about blue in general is that, like Vice said, like white is about healing and lots of low-level small creatures. Green is about healing and just plain lots of creatures. It's like a rush like Force of Nature deck. Black is about decay and some high level creatures. Red is more about magical damage and lots of low level creatures. But blue is about manipulating the game, and a lot of its creatures have flying, which is just a pain in the ass because a lot you can't block them.
Especially
unless
you're green, because barely any green creatures have flying. Yeah, there are.
The best you could do is like giant spiders, which can block creatures
with
flying.
I was just going to say, there are spiders that can block flying creatures.
But of course,
but
can't
can
fly themselves.
Flying.
Yeah, but blue is just manipulation everywhere. It's terrible.
So I have several thoughts on this, and I'll try to go through them in order very quickly. One is that Rosewater always says that the easiest thing that he can explain to players is flying, which is a mechanic that tends to be on blue and white cards a lot.
Yeah.
So a card has flying on it. He says, this is flying. Most players instantly understand what flying is. It means that that creature can fly over other creatures that can't fly, meaning those non-flying creatures can't block the flying guy.
Correct.
And the flying guy can block other flying creatures. So there are creatures like the giant spider that Vice mentioned that can block flying creatures even though they do not themselves have flying. That ability didn't have a keyword for a very long time. It did as of about like 10 or 11 years ago. And they tried to give it a very evocative name that explains exactly what that ability is. They called it Reach.
It is Reach, yeah.
So they just reach up and they grab the flyer out of the sky.
Pretty much.
And so like the spiders have Reach, and some like giants have Reach, because it makes sense for giants to have Reach.
I would imagine archers would have it too, right?
Archers are more likely to be able to do damage to flying creatures.
Okay.
Yeah, archers don't block, you know?
Yeah, so what Vice is talking about is actually a lesson they learned while they're developing Magic. That it turns out, imagine I play a creature, and it gets killed immediately by like a lightning bolt.
It's so annoying.
I don't get to attack with it, but it just gets killed immediately. That's a red spell.
Yeah.
Now I do the same thing. I play the creature, but it gets countered by a blue counterspell.
Yeah, it doesn't even come out.
Counterspells are almost always blue. The effect on the gameplay is usually the same, but it turns out players have a much, much stronger negative reaction to the blue spell.
It's a pain in the ass.
because at least they got to put their creature on the battlefield before it got killed. And they just like that better.
Well, that's the thing. It's a power grab. Because with lightning, you're like, I send my lightning spell your way. Like, you better watch out for my offensive powers. But with blue, it's like it's like you're reaching into the other guy's face. I'm not going to let you do that. You
know? It's the equivalent of Dr. Evil going, zip.
Yeah,
I was thinking of the like Dikembe Mutombo commercial where he's just like knocking things
no,
out of
no,
hands
no.
And going the no no no.
I love that.
That's basically a blue player. So it turns out that part of what Magic's strengths is that the colors individually have weaknesses and strengths.
Sure.
And you have to choose between playing a deck that's a single color and it has certain strengths and weaknesses, maybe bringing in the second color to cover some of that first color's weaknesses. But that also brings an inherent weakness into your deck, because now you have to juggle two different colors of mana in your deck and to be able to cast two different types of spells. So there's always an interesting give and take between that.
Well, by the way,
in Blue's case, the weakness is that it's very good at dealing with things that are in your hand. It's good at drawing cards. It's good at countering spells. But it's very bad at dealing with things that a lot of creatures that have been resolved already on the board. So the answer to blue is usually to play a very aggressive deck with a lot of little creatures that come out before the blue player can play all their counter spells. The problem with that is that a lot of players come and they open this big 6-mana-cost dragon or like 7-mana-cost demon, and there's no way, unless they have like a very strongly constructed aggressive deck, that they can get that creature out before the blue player can keep up their counterspell mana. So the solution to that has been to tune down counterspell magic a lot, because it's been driving players away from the game. And it's an interesting sort of social dynamic that mirrors like the casual versus hardcore player discussion at a very high level, that players who grew up playing blue like don't really understand this reaction and feel like they're being unfairly penalized, not really understanding that games, especially multiplayer games, are not a zero-sum game. And like, it's cool that you're having fun countering a player's spells, but you do have to acknowledge, based on the data, that your fun is coming at the significant expense of somebody else's.
No, I was gonna mention about counterspells, like two things. One, if memory serves, the original counterspell costs like 2 mana. It's dirt cheap. Like I've seen a remake of counterspell. It's literally the same card, except it costs 4 mana, because like 2 mana is just bullshit. But the other thing I wanted to mention, another reason counterspells might be more annoying than a lightning bolt, even if it produces the same effect. A lightning bolt hits a player for damage, or it hits a creature for damage or for the kill, but a counterspell can unless a card specifically says it can't be countered, and there are a few of those, Counterspell can shut down anything but land. Like, anything. Like, no matter what you're trying to do. Like, I'm going to play something from my hand, and a blue player's like, no, you're not. Like, it's the biggest right. pain in the ass in the freaking world. And it's an instant effect. So, if somebody has a Counterspell, he's going to use it, unless you counter his Counterspell, and, like, you better both be playing blue and have Counterspells in your hand. Like, right. Counterspell is just such a royal nuisance.
So, yeah, invoking that negative emotional response from a player is why many, like, players who play all Counterspell decks are Timmies at their heart.
Yeah, you finally get that 10-10 creature. Nope, graveyard. Like, immediately.
So the other two are Johnny / Jenny, which is a player that approaches the game as a challenge to be solved. So these players often play, like, puzzles, like Professor Layton games. These are the kinds of people, since I used the Scrabble analogy already, who do things like try to play the word ZZZ.
Oh, okay.
Which, you know, is exceedingly difficult to do if you ever played Scrabble, because you have to use the only Z tile plus the two blanks.
Yeah. Yeah.
Meaning it doesn't score you very many points at all, because you're basically wasting the two blanks to play ZZZ.
Yeah.
and the last would be, most players who play, like, very complicated combo decks. Like a player who would want to make use of Balduvian Shaman, which doesn't seem on its surface to be very powerful, would be a Johnny.
That's how I am in fighting games. Like, I will sacrifice a round if I could just get that one super move off. Like, if I hit you and then you proceed to kick my ass, like, I don't care, I got the move off.
Yeah, I'm very much a Johnny.
Yeah.
Definitely Timmy, but I think it's a little bit of both, understand. So it's not a hardcore categorization. There are aspects of both that blend in, but it's sort of a spectrum that you can take pieces of to understand how you approach games. The last is Spike, and since I've covered for you already two types of gamers who don't really care about winning, you can imagine which kind of gamer Spike is.
Just likes to win no matter what.
Yeah, the broad sense, the positive way of spinning it is that Spike is the kind of player who comes to the game looking to prove something to themselves. So, for example, Vice is a Spike on the way in. You know, you're coming to prove something to yourself. And then also to prove something, to use that as a lesson to teach other people how to live a healthy life. You know, so that is a Spike mentality.
I would
You're
say
challenging
that
yourself.
I bring a Spike mentality to most things that I'm into,
yeah.
actually.
Mm-hmm. So, like, personal success is a Spike mentality. So that's also why many poker players are also professional Magic players, because they're good at what they do. So, again, I would encourage our listeners. I'll wrap up this segment because I've talked about Magic for 37 minutes, and I can talk about it for, just like wrestling, I can talk about it for more time than we have recorded Corrective Consciousness for the entirety of the podcast. But I would encourage our listeners to talk about what kind of player psychographics they represent and what they bring to the table and what they look for when they play games. And also to check out that talk to see how the designers of Magic have tried to teach other game developers to take advantage of what you bring to the table uniquely.
Nice. Well, then I will take off on the next segment, in that I wanted to talk about one of my favorite video game companies in length, and I've had a couple episodes leading up to this, and I think I brought it up last week's podcasts and a little bit in CoreCon earlier this week. So Falcom is one of my favorite video game companies. They are a really cool video game company that has survived an extremely long time through thick and thin on a lot of their releases. I mean, they are a company that is very old in terms of video games. They are from, like, the early 80s. Their first big game was Xanadu for the PC 98 or PC 88, I think. Even it's like a really old game. It's the PC 88, I think, and maybe some systems before that. So it was a very popular RPG in Japan that was made was a native Japanese game. So just to give you an idea, back then computer games were pretty much all made by Western companies, and a lot of them were ports of and localizations of US games in particular, and British games. So a lot of the big RPGs in Japan at the time, and a lot of what was popular was were games like Ultima and Wizardry. In fact, to this day, the Wizardry series is decidedly a Japanese series, even though it was it has origins in basically just being coded in a basement in America. So that's because Wizardry got so popular in Japan that they pretty much just took the reins because it became less and less popular in its home country and just continued on in Japan to the point where a lot of times, most of the games in the series, I think at this point, are Japanese games and that we haven't received. So it's pretty interesting to think about that at that time. So therefore, that's where games like Final Fantasy and Dragon Quest came from. They came from games like Wizardry and Ultima, probably Ultima in particular for those two games. They're descended from American RPG design, which is descended in turn from D&D, Dungeons and Dragons. You have this game called Xanadu come out, and it's one of the very first Japanese homegrown RPGs, and people loved it. And in fact, we got a port of it as well. We got a localization of it way back when. Some people may recognize that name from the NES game Faxanadu, which is a combination, it's a portmanteau of Famicom and Xanadu. It is a sequel of sorts to the original Xanadu. It plays very similarly to Zelda 2. In fact, I think they have some common DNA in that they were kind of released in a similar time frame. I think Faxanadu might be a little older than Zelda 2, but not by much. They were kind of were on the same thought process. So Falcom, though, is most famous for the Ys series. So that is the correct pronunciation of the series that is spelled Ys. So like a lot of people would call that Ys back in the day, or you know, something to that degree, but it's called Ys, which is based off of a similar legend to Atlantis. It's like about it's a French legend of a floating island. So it's similar to Atlantis in its tropes and kind of mysteries surrounding it. But it is based off of a French legend. So if anybody's wondering why it's spelled weird, and unlike any other Japanese name, that's because it's borrowed from French. But anyway, Falcom is great in it with those games. Those games were so much fun. They were a great adventure game series, Ys was, that centered around this character named Adol, who's red-haired and very iconic. And he goes around and like saves, you know, pretty maidens, and also had this interesting mechanic. So in a world where you know, there were turn-based RPGs, this was an early attempt at an action RPG that was supposed to be for, you know, controls that weren't that complicated. So these games centered around essentially bumping in. Your character bumping into enemies without, you know, pressing a sword button or, you know, an attack button of any sort. It's like an overhead game like Zelda, but you bump into enemies to kill them. If you bump them head on, there's a good chance that the bad guy can attack you while during this, and you can get hurt. So what you have to do is you kind of have to hit them at a skewed angle. You cannot move diagonally, so you kind of have to just aim for a bad guy, you know, kind of like off-center, if that makes sense, in order to do significant damage to them and also not get hurt yourself. So that mechanic was pretty fun, but a lot of people don't like it because it's kind of archaic nowadays. So it has since evolved to kind of have the Zelda-ish attack button, you know, to sword swipe. It's a great series to get into now because we have so much access to almost the entire thing. I would say that most people can buy almost the entire series very easily off of Steam and GOG and good old games. So what's good about, and also the best versions of those games ever released. So every game in the series has been remade a ton except for Ys 5. Nowadays we have access to Origin, which is like the episode zero. 1 and 2 are almost always bundled together, and in the Steam release it is, and it's the best version of 1 and 2 you could ever play. It's been remade and it's very entertaining and a lot of fun. And 3, Oath and Fil'Ghanah, it is a remake of 3. 3 was actually, Ys 3 for a long time was a black sheep of the series. It was very similar to Zelda 2 in a lot of ways. It was side-scrolling, and fact, Xanadu by extension. It was side-scrolling, and it had an attack button. At that point in the series, it was the first game to have an attack button. It was also very difficult, and it had kind of a lackluster story compared to the first two games. So people didn't really like that one. I mean, some people, it had a lot of different versions too. There was PC 98 version, the Super Nintendo, and the Genesis. A lot of people played the Super Nintendo version and decided they didn't like it and never wanted to play it ever again. Which is understandable because the Super Nintendo one is by far the hardest of all the three original versions. If you play the Genesis one, it's actually pretty fun, but it's still a mess of a game. So they remade it some years later in the 2000s and called it Oath and Fil'Ghanah. It doesn't play at all like Ys 3 ever did, but it has the same overall story and it has remixes of all the music and also overhead versions of all of the stages, and turns out to probably be the best Ys game ever made. So they took essentially what people think count as probably the worst game in the series and turned it into probably the best one. So great place to start. If you want to start playing these games, go for it, because that game's great. And then there's Ys 4, which was recently remade for the Vita. That one is called Celceta, I believe. And that one's a really great game, too, and that recently got patched to play on PlayStation TV. And then there's 5, which never got a port anywhere. It was exclusively made for the Super Nintendo and is another black sheep in the series. And I think it wasn't even made by Hudson. It was made by an outsourced company. So you have to play a fan translation of that game. And then there's 6, which is Ark of Nepishtim, which is very accessible. PC version is available on GOG and Steam. And it's also on PS2 and PSP, but you should probably avoid those two at this point because you have the PC versions are by far the best. And then 7 came out for PSP, also playable on PlayStation TV. And the new one is coming out is Lacrimosa of Dana, which is the dumbest name in history.
I don't maybe know, other than what, maybe what about Duodecum. Spy 2?
Yeah, Spy 2 is pretty bad.
Ark of Nepishtim is pretty up there.
Ark of Nepishtim's up there. Oath and Fil'Ghanah is pretty bad.
Final Fantasy Dissidia Duodecim.
Yeah, Duodecum is pretty bad. The Kingdom Hearts 328 over whatever.
Oh, over, my like, God. Over however many days.
That takes the cake, that one. Because... Why did you do that?
From what I've heard, there actually is a reason, but like you're not,
yes, you don't know that when you get it on the shelf. You're marketing it to people that don't know that.
Yeah, well, that's the whole thing. When you see it on the shelf, oh, what's this? Oh, an improper fraction, and it's for days.
So anyway, Falcom is a great company. All of these games have fantastic soundtracks. That is one of the things that's most consistent throughout the entirety of all of their games is that they have what's called the Neon Falcom Music Club or something like that. It's equivalent to like Konami's house band or house musicians, and also Taito's house musicians. Those three companies have, you know, like musicians that are just hired there to make beautiful music for their games, and Falcom is another one of those companies that actually has that. The music in all of the PC releases that I just mentioned that are on Steam and GOG are all amazing. They've been remixed and redone a lot of times, but their current state is almost universally the best versions of all those songs, and they just get better over time. So I fully recommend playing those games if you are a fan of action-adventure games. They're all very accessible and a lot of fun. Oath and Felgun is a good place to start. The other recent ones, like Seven's a lot of fun. I really enjoyed Seven quite a bit. And Celsada is a lot of fun as well. So I can't wait to play the new one. But one thing that I wanted to mention is the complicated history of the Dragon Slayer series. So Old Man Stompy was talking about the Legend of Heroes series. He's currently playing the Trails of Cold Steel games. So that is part of a larger series called the Dragon Slayer series. And there has never been a more confusing series than this series. The only other series that kind of rivals it is the Wonder Boy series and how confusing it is and the numbering of things. So, Dragon Slayer is one of the original games that was released, by Falcom in the 80s. It is a game they released after Xanadu. It's before Xanadu. I'm sorry. So, Xanadu was a very popular game, but before that was Dragon Slayer. Dragon Slayer is their like first attempt at making an RPG, and it is very rudimentary and very hard to play. But pretty much all of the non-ease games are part of this series in one way or another. So you can kind of view it as Falcom's house series. It's like any game that is not Ys is or Zwei or Gururumin is a Dragon Slayer game. So Xanadu and Xanadu Next are part of the sub series that came after the original Dragon Slayer game. And then there's this Romancia series after that. And then there's Drazzle Family, which is another sub series, which includes Legacy of the Wizard for the NES. And then there's Sorcerian, which is a weird, I think it's a strategy game. And then there's Legend of Heroes, which has its own subseries. Legend of Heroes...
In that sense, it's like Dragon Guard's its own series, but Nier is its own subseries.
Correct.
Well, I would go and compare it to like Megami Tensei, where there's like many, where it's basically the Atlas House series, and there are many, many, many subseries within that.
Sure.
Exactly. So, you have the original Dragon Slayer, which we got released on the Turbo CD, we never got Dragon Slayer 2. But then the next Legend of Heroes game to come out was actually the third one, and that was the Legend of Heroes trilogy for the PSP. So this is named as the Gaggarv trilogy.
Sure.
And not a good place to start. For people that want to get into Falcom, they were poorly localized. They were localized in the wrong order. So I said this in the last podcast, but it was released in the order of 2, 1, and 3. So if you are going to play them, get Legend of Heroes 2 and play that first. then Legend of Heroes 1, and then Legend of Heroes 3.
Although that's certainly not easy to do, because they're not available on the PS Store at all.
Correct. They were localized by Ubisoft and then quickly forgotten, and therefore are difficult to get, and now that Falcom has a larger fan base, they're difficult to get, and they're not very good. I'm just going to put it right out there.
Yeah. So to expound on the experience I mentioned during the previous podcast, I spent a lot of time trying to track down a copy of the original Legend of Heroes, and I wound up finding a used copy at one of the last Blockbuster stores in America, in Ocean City, New Jersey. And it was not worth the wait.
They are not good games. They're not localized well. They're not worth your time. I'm just going to throw that out there. But what is worth your time, if you want a traditional Japanese RPG, is the next game in the series, which is the original Trails in the Sky. For a long time, it looked like we were never going to get these games. They were extremely popular in Japan, sold extremely well on PSP, were very, very highly regarded in Japan, but they're monsters of games. The second game is on two UMDs. I think it's the only game that takes up two UMDs.
Yeah, I've never heard of that.
And so therefore it's a monster of a game to localize. I won't bore you with the entire saga that took up the time for the second game in the Trails in the Sky series to come out here, but you should look up the article that Kotaku hosted, because it's fantastic. The guy who was making it was under so much stress that he almost killed himself. Just to give you an idea. It was an extreme undertaking. It's probably the largest game ever localized, without even a joke. It has probably more dialogue and more stuff to translate than any other game ever. That being said, we're also getting the third one, miraculously. Nobody ever thought the third game would ever come out, and it's going to be here in May, the beginning of May. So those games are great. They're a lot of fun. They're very much a traditional RPG with a ton of charm and attention to detail. So if you're into that kind of thing, go for it. Then there were two games in between that trilogy called Zero no Kiseki and I no Kiseki. That would be Trails to Zero or Trails and Trails to Azure. That is the sequel to the series. Trails in the Sky series. However, we skipped those two to be more current. So Xseed is translating the Trails in the Cold Steel, or Trails of Cold Steel series right now, and they have 1 and 2 already out, and 3 will probably follow pretty soon once it comes out in Japan. So these are all great points to jump on. I would say that if you want start with one of the number one entries in any of these trilogies and move forward. So play either the first Trails in the Sky game or the first Trails of Cold Steel. They're both good jumping on points. There are references to the older games, but you'll get over it. They're more just flavor text and fun stuff rather than something that will bog you down. I guess my whole point in talking about all these is that Falcom invariably makes great games. If you go onto Steam, there are a lot of games by them. Almost all of their games within the last 20 years are on there. There is a game called Gurumen that is extremely charming. That is another action-adventure game. Kind of like Ease in some ways, but... a lot simpler and a lot more childlike, but it's still a lot of fun, and I definitely recommend playing that one. That is localized by Mastiff, of all companies, and it took a long time for us to get the PC version, but we finally got it. Go ahead.
Well, they also did La Pucelle, right? So for a little while, they were trying to carve out a niche as a translator of obscure Japanese titles.
Yeah, and they did a much better job with Gurumen than they did with La Pucelle. La Pucelle was famously butchered. It was very much a lot of references were ripped out of that game in order to make it less offensive, I guess, for religion. But a lot of that game's entire motifs are based around like things that Joan of Arc would have. It's supposed to call to your mind Joan of Arc, and Joan of Arc is a Christian hero. So it doesn't make much sense.
The entire game is themed around like working in the church and things like that.
Yeah. So they took all religious references out.
I guess you just play Jeanne d'Arc for the PSP if you really want the authentic Joan of Arc experience.
That's actually a really good game, by the way.
It is.
But I also did want to point out that there's also Xanadu Next, which is a fantastic game, which we finally received on Steam, I think, earlier last year. That is one of the best RPGs ever made. It's really, really good, and we didn't have much access to that game for a long time as English speakers. So we got an English version of the game in the worst spot imaginable. So I don't know if you guys were aware of this, but it came out on the N-Gage.
Wow. right up there with that one Elder Scrolls game.
There are two, I believe.
Jesus.
Two Elder Scrolls games that never got ported elsewhere. On the Nokia N-Gage.
God damn.
Go for it. But, yeah. So, a really obviously bad port of that game to begin with. So, do not waste your time. But it was fan-translated. A lot of Falcom games were fan-translated before XSEED made it their mission to bring over almost all of them.
Actually, that reminds me. Which game was it? I think it might have been one of the Ease games. Didn't XSEED like pull a first in history and just pay for a fan translation that already existed?
Yeah, I think that was for Oath and Fel'Ghana, if I remember correctly.
Okay, that's really super cool, though.
Yeah, I mean, there's a big controversy surrounding it as well. There's like a lot of internet drama around fan translation. So unfortunately, it might have been a bad decision because they could have just retranslated it. And even though it being an undertaking, it probably would have brought them less trouble in the end.
Yeah,
I don't even want to get into it because the whole thing is stupid and very high school. But there was a big controversy around that specific fan translation being used and getting paid for. So anyway, I just wanted to point out how good the titles that they come out with are. Like it's no joke that their name is usually a brand of quality, except for those PSP games, which really weren't their fault. There was a number of problems with those three PSP Legend of Heroes games. One of them being that it was a they're poor ports of PC games, first of all, and that they didn't port themselves, and they got translated poorly in the worst way possible and got released in awful ways. So usually if they are in control of their own product for the most part, and they have a good responsible localizer, like localization company like XSEED or NIS is doing some of their games, the new Ease game is going to be localized by NIS.
Oh, no kidding.
I think mostly because XSEED is using all their resources to do the Legend of Heroes games.
Sure.
Their priority is there. What's up?
Makes sense to me.
Yeah, yeah. Those games are gigantic, so...
Yeah, that reminds me. I think when you... I forgot where I found out about it, but I was surprised that XSEED was not doing an Ease game.
Yeah, yeah. So it was NIS. I think they got a bid or something like that, but I think they're okay with it. Because I think they're such Ease nerds that they're okay with it being localized at all.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I think it's a little bit of a disappointment, but at least it's coming to America. Now, I also wanted to point out that they are, at the forefront of localizing PSP games that way past the PSP's, lifespan. Ooh. Not only did they release Legend of Heroes 2 on the PSP as a download title, unfortunately there was no physical copy of that, but, that was probably I think that was the last PSP game to be released. if I'm not mistaken.
So, you specifically mean Trails in the Sky, second chapter.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that was the last PSP game released in the United States. If not, then it was Class of Heroes, which is a similarly niche. That game's more like Wizardry, actually, or Etrian Odyssey.
The second chapter just came out last year for the PSP in the US, pretty hard for another game to come out after it.
Yeah, and before that, they also released Brandish, which is a remake of a Super Nintendo game, a Super Nintendo era game. So Falcom, they had some really great PC games at the time, including this game called Brandish back in the 90s, which was an overhead game, and its whole gimmick was that you could change the camera angle, like you could swoop it around your character and get like a different angle. So like imagine Zelda, but you could switch the angle in the room in which you were looking at. Like you could look at it from the right side of the room.
I'm thinking like the new Paper Mario game for like the Wii, right? Where you can go 2D and 3D, and like all of a sudden you could do different things based on which way you're facing.
Kind of, but more like the overhead camera can switch to different axes.
Okay.
So that was its gimmick, but it was a lot smoother on the PC at the time because it could render things like that easily. On a Super Nintendo, it was very jarring. It would just switch from the left side of the room automatically to the right if you press like the R trigger or the R shoulder button, and so like you would be disoriented when you played that game. So like it was very difficult to play. They remade it on PSP. It was actually one of the very first PSP games ever released in Japan. It was during like the first year of the PSP, and we never got it. And it is infinitely superior to the original game. We got that Super Nintendo game in English. It was released by Koei at the time. It was localized by Koei, but it's not fun to play. It just isn't. But the PSP game is great. It's really, really good. It's a dungeon crawler game. There's like a lot of traps and things like that. But it's also an action RPG a la Ys or something like that. So it's a lot of fun, but it's very difficult. But it's not now on the PSP. It's not a game that is hard because of its mechanics, but hard because it's a good difficult game. You know, so that got released on PSP only like 2 or 3 years ago, way after they stopped making UMDs for almost every other game. So the whole fandom surrounding this company is really, really neat. I recommend anything that of theirs that was released past 2000, essentially, because they've been very, very good, very consistent, and now we have way more access to their games than we ever used to. I used to have to import these games from Japan directly, and they were such a pain in the ass to get, because you would have to order it from Falcom's actual website, which didn't have, like, you would need to email them and give them your credit card number rather than go to like an online shop. And they knew scarce English too. So like to take advantage of ordering from them, you'd have to go through some hoops. They tried their best, of course, but they were really nice about it and flattered that somebody in America would want their games. But it still was a big hassle, and now you could just download them very, very easily and cheaply. They go on sale quite a bit. So I just wanted to go over my love of the series and how diverse their games are, and why I love them so much. I mean, they just have a really nice attention to detail, and their action games are just so quick and fun to play. Like the Ys games in particular, you can just mow through enemies very, very quickly, and it's so satisfying. Like all the enemies like splatter into like little blood clouds, and it's just so much fun to play. So I don't know if either of you want to have any input in this, but I just wanted to express my love of that company.
Yeah, so most of my experience with the Ys games came from outside looking in. I remember reading about Wanderers from Ys for the Super Nintendo in an issue of Nintendo Power. Like, it must have been like 15 years ago, maybe 20 years ago by now. And thinking it would be a fun game to play, you know, and then like checking it out at a you know, a Blockbuster or something, and then realizing that was not the case at all. But like later I wound up, I mean, you've gotten into detail about why that is like one of the worst entry points of the series, but much later I got into game soundtracks, and I knew like Falcom as a leader in terms of publishing things like remix soundtracks that we now take for granted. For people who appreciate video game music, I picked up a CD called The Very Best of Ys that was released for the series' 10th anniversary at an Otakon. I actually bought a bootleg copy first, but then later I bought the real one from a retailer, and I was like, this is Ys? Like, what have I been missing? Like, this isn't even probably from the game, because these are all from Super Nintendo games, but like this company and this band have been producing this music for years. Like, I got the CD, it was old, and it's 10th anniversary CD, so they've been doing this for a long time.
They actually play these games, this music in concert quite often, and they're very popular. And they're a hair metal band when they play it. Like that's their persona, on stage persona. They're very much like an '80s hair metal band when they play, and they're really. There's actually clips of there's like recordings of their concerts online on YouTube. Definitely seek them out, because they're a blast, and their music is very much thrash metal. Like it's very exciting and very indicative of what you're doing in the games at the time. Mm-hmm. Oath and Fil'Gana and Ys 3 in general has some of the best music that they've ever made, which is part of why it's a shame that the original version of 3 is a bad game overall. In fact, the Genesis version of that soundtrack is one of my favorites of all time. Even though probably the Oath and Fil'Gana remixes are better, I just love that FN synth.
I mean, it's also
that chip.
It's also unfortunate that for most gamers growing up, they probably had a Super Nintendo or a Genesis, and not necessarily access to, you know, a PC Engine.
So
I'm sure that hindered the series taking hold in America for a pretty long time.
Yeah, I mean, for the longest time, I think there was a Master System release of 1, mm-hmm. and who had a Master System, right? So
you did.
I did in college, way okay. longer. I mean, I didn't even know what a Master System was until I read about it in, like, right. I was a reader of Nintendo Power, so I didn't know there was anything outside of Nintendo products mm-hmm. for a long time. Most people only know 3 from that time period, because, you know, who had a TurboGrafx CD back then? I mean, very few people. And TurboGrafx CD had versions of 1, 2, and 3 localized in English, and they were great, and they had fantastic soundtracks, but they were like the claim to fame for the system. Like, if anybody ever was bragging about having a TurboGrafx, they were bragging with Ys.
Yeah.
Which is kind of funny, considering it's a great game, it's not on the same tier as Link to the Past. Like, it doesn't even compare.
You work with what you have, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's a much older game, right? But it would appear that it was released around the same time period, right? So, like, Ys 1 and 2 were released, like, way long before on a PC, and then they ported it to TurboGrafx later. Yeah. So it's a much older game with older mechanics, released around the same time period as, you know, one of the best games ever made.
Back around 2000, when I was in college, date myself a little bit, there was a guy, I used to be a moderator on one of the IGN forums, and there was a guy who posted there who eventually got banned because he was a real weird guy. He was convinced that Adolf Christian was like the Ubermensch, basically. Like, he was the greatest protagonist in video game history. And I will say that it's kind of interesting that he is the kind of character who goes to, like, all these disparate worlds, and he is always, like, the savior. You know, so in terms of, like, video game accomplishments, Adolf Christian might be one of the most accomplished video game characters.
What's cool about him is that there's a lot of running jokes in the Falcom games that they acknowledge.
Yeah.
At the beginning of every game, he shows up on a beach, like from a shipwreck, Right. And he goes on to save whatever land he falls into, and then escapes and then goes to get into a storm and then fall right back on another beach and save that next world. So that they acknowledge that it's not like it's not like it's hackneyed.
It's also like his best friend Dogi. His claim to fame is that he breaks through a wall to rescue Adol at some point in basically every game.
Yeah, that started in East 2, I believe, and continues throughout the rest of the series. You can actually play as him in East 7, because you could switch characters in that game. Mm-hmm. And you could play as him in Celceta as well, I think. But it's also probably one of the best jokes in the entire series is in the TurboGrafx CD version of 4. Which was Japan only and was fan translated recently. Now Celceta is a remake of 4, so right. But is almost completely different from the other versions of 4. 4 is the one of the most complicated points in the series, because the fourth Ys game was made by not by Falcom in any way. Celceta was the first one that was made by them. So, therefore, it's canon. However, the Super Nintendo one was outsourced to some other company. And the PC Engine version was made by Hudson. And so, all three games are drastically different from each other. They all involve the same area. They all involve the same land. But they are all completely different games. You could actually play all three of them as if they were separate games. They're not substitutes for each other. But anyway, the TurboGrafx CD version of 4 has this great joke where you, where Adol was kidnapped, and put into jail, into a jail cell, and Dogi finally crushes a wall. And you go, and he saves you, and you walk through the wall with him, and you find that he had actually pretty much burrowed through this entire building. He crushed every single wall he came into contact with, including ones that had like doors that were easily accessible. So he just basically tunneled straight towards Adol to save him, which was fantastic. It's a really funny joke. So. Well, anyway, I think I murdered everybody who didn't care about Falcom one bit. So
I'm sure we'll talk about it more, you know, because I know
Pyro is a huge Falcom fan,
and so I've also played pretty much everything that's come out in America since the date you mentioned.
Yeah,
in at least one form. So I look forward to their new stuff.
Yeah. So definitely play. The Lacrimosa of Dana, which is coming out soon. I'm sure it will be great, just like the rest of these games are. And yeah, that's pretty much it. So please leave us feedback here on in the comments about what you like about Falcom, and also if I talk too long. So, and that's the show for this week. Please remember to subscribe to Corrective Consciousness's YouTube and SoundCloud pages. While there, give us thumbs up, likes, and 5-star ratings on iTunes. It helps us promote and spread awareness of the show, and any bit of encouragement helps to keep the show going. You can also catch us on Tuesday, our sister podcast, Corrective Consciousness, the podcast about our lives in pop culture. Finally, you can find me as Vise the Bold, VYSETHEBOLD, on Steam, PSN, Xbox Live, and Twitter.
And you can find me on YouTube. My channel is simply called Lotus Prince, and on Twitter at Lotus Prince, all one word.
And you can find me as Old Man Stompy, basically everywhere I want to be found. Of course, every time I give this outro, I come across as kind of a misanthrope. That's why I'm uniquely qualified to be the community manager and to run our Facebook page.
Yes.
So please give our podcast lots of likes and comments when we post it there, which will happen on Thursday, probably while you're listening to this. Otherwise, I'll see you around.
All right. Well, we'll catch you next week on Tuesday for Corrective Consciousness, folks. Catch you then.
Until next time, everyone.
Cheers.